5 months into the Trump administration, how are his strong supporters feeling? And how about his opponents? What's their plan? In our latest voter panel, we sat down with Republicans, Democrats, and an independent to take their pulse. And we start with a registered Democrat who voted for Gary Johnson for president, but who says he's come around to supporting President Trump.
My feeling is very complicated. I voted for Johnson, so I was that third party voter. However, I have been moving towards the president. There are people who are opposing him, not necessarily on policy, but just because they just don't like him. And I don't like that. So I provide some support because I think it's important that we support the president. We're all in this together.
I guess it's just the rhetoric. It's like we're in a perpetual campaign now. And I think both parties need to take responsibility for the radicals on each side of the aisle and start to really influence the parties to make positive change for average people.
It's not just the rhetoric. It's not just this Twitter feed. It's the policies that he is enacting. It's the policies that he's pulling out of. This is daily doing damage to our country and to our future generations and to the world.
I just think if we give him a little bit of time and we all work together, Democrats, Republicans, and we cut out the crazy, we'll be all right.
Cut out the crazy. That's a good national motto. When you hear the folks on this side or other Trump supporters say, you got to give him a chance. Hasn't been long enough. What do you say?
It shouldn't take 6 months. It shouldn't take 6 weeks. The office of presidency is not a place to cut your teeth on government.
I don't think it's in our best interest to try to focus on the areas where we disagree. I think we should try to start where we agree: infrastructure, tax reform, you know, getting more jobs, you know, taking care of America. Who is against that? Let's start there, and then we can kind of work from there, and you know, maybe turn off his Twitter. You know,
show of hands, wish that he would stop the Twitter. Why are you half and half on stopping the Twitter?
I'll be honest, it's like watching a train wreck. But at the same time, I mean, he's telling us things that he shouldn't be telling us that are going to get him in trouble. And really, he's kind of helping speed that process, I believe, of getting him out of office just because he can't shut up.
Trump hasn't actually done anything to anybody. He's tweeted. He hasn't really passed any major legislation. So where's the travel ban right now? It's being struck down at every turn. So there are mechanisms we have in place to deal with a personality as big as Trump. And we have to just give him a chance to, and I hate to use his vernacular, but drain the swamp. We have so many people at the trough.
I don't think he's draining the swamp. He's filling the swamp with more of the same. How many people are from Goldman Sachs that he's working with? How many people is he bringing in there because they're billionaires and they're going to make money from it? I think that's part of the problem.
Every other administration has done the same thing. So he may not be draining the swamp in that aspect, but when he's trying to, you know, shrink the size of government, I think that we should give him a chance.
Let's start bringing some jobs home by starting to make his ties here. I mean, why can't he bring his companies and Ivanka's companies here to America to create jobs? You got to lead by example. You're the leader of the free world.
I somewhat agree with that, but I do think he's made some changes that are positive fiscally. You know, the Paris Accord, I think, you know, rattling NATO in my mind was a good thing. You know, that is another deal that I consider to be a raw deal as far as America's concerned.
I mean, I think Putin's getting exactly what he wants out of all this, that you shake up NATO and then it shakes up our leadership, it shakes up our relationships, and Russia has had a clear impact globally. I mean, this Putin's not stupid. I mean, I think that he's got his claws in globally. And it feels to me that the shaking up of NATO, to me, is not a good thing. I don't disagree that we're paying more than our fair share. I don't disagree with that. But I think there's a way to negotiate that. And this is the guy who says he can make the best deals ever. And I haven't seen that yet.
Well, you know, it's back to the, you know, give him a little time concept. I think, you know, what he did with NATO is step one, you know, and that's to bring everybody to the table.
I disagree. I disagree. I don't think he's bringing people to the table. I think he's alienating the United States from the rest of the world. And pulling out of the Paris Agreement was just horrible. Bad decision. alienating our allies even at this point. So we aren't, our international diplomacy is horrible.
Well, I kind of disagree because I think he has achieved great success over the years with that posture and that approach, and I think he's using the same approach with all his negotiations. They all have to start somewhere.
But that's in business. The way that you conduct business is not the way that you run a country.
He is our president. What is it like for you as non-supporters to have to function?
I'm really struggling. I'm struggling to not stay in my little echo chamber on social media. I started a company called Rise Travel, and we take people to, we do the travel and logistics to get people to and from marches and rallies and things like that. It just definitely lit a fire for me.
Michael.
I have decided that at my level that I am running for Congress. I'm going to run for the U.S. House of Representatives to represent Ohio's 10th District.
Is that right?
Yes. I plan to do what Democrats never do, which is to go out into all parts of my district, including the rural Republican parts, and give them my message and say, let's open a dialogue. I don't think that I would have even considered this had Hillary Clinton won.
Okay, last question. Hillary Clinton is sort of dancing around the edges of public stage. Is she still a leader in the Democratic Party?
I think it's past Hillary. I think we need a new vision. I think we need people who are not the common politician. And let's really create a future that is viable for all of us. All of us.
So one of the things that I heard from them and that I've heard from a lot of voters, and I think this is interesting that this is sort of taken root, the two-party system, Republican, Democrat, is not cutting it for them anymore. They want other options. They don't want to just be put in those boxes. A lot of them said that they feel fiscally conservative but socially moderate, and they don't know where to go with those feelings. Which party for that?
I mean, you know, in truth, I've been hearing that probably since I was like 8.
Right, so maybe it's time to do something about
that. Well, third parties never get any purchase, whether it's because of the money or the dominant personalities that wind up populating the major parties. It doesn't happen.
I hear you, but it feels like there's maybe a tipping point, maybe something is changing. And if enough people say, we want to break out of this mold, then maybe something happens.
Maybe. We will see.